are listening to This is Oklahoma, hosted by Mike Hearn, telling stories of Oklahomans and those that have made it their home.
Before we get into today's episode, I want to tell you a little bit about our current sponsors, the Oklahoma Hall of Fame. As you well know, if you've been following This is Oklahoma, they've been a huge part of this podcast. So this podcast is presented by the Oklahoma Hall of Fame, telling Oklahoma's story through its people since 1927. For more information on the Hall of Fame, go to www.oklahomahof.com and follow them on Instagram for daily updates at OklahomaHOF. Also, for the podcast, a new sponsor this year that's just come on board and super excited to announce RCB Bank. Since 1936, RCB Bank has offered progressive products and a friendly service. Come in today to find out more about their loan promotion on new used refinance cars, boats, campers, and ATVs. Visit RCB Bank to learn more. RCB Bank, that's my bank. With approved credit, restrictions apply. Now, let's get into today's episode. What's up, guys? Welcome back to another episode of This is Oklahoma. Mike Hearn here, your host, back with another episode in Tulsa today with Roni Jackson Kerr. And really excited, right? Because I have a lot of people on the podcast and we're getting close to 300 now. And, you know, there's not a lot of people that I have on the podcast that kind of do the same thing that I do, right? Is like have a really cool page. Because I really do think you have a really cool page. And I really appreciate you taking awesome photos, because as I was driving up here, I'm like, I rely on you probably a lot more than you think, because I can always like, there's a few people who have like, you know, core followings like yourself and post very good consistent stuff that I know that like, if I'm struggling to find a post, I'm like, you're one of those people. And I just want to say, I really appreciate that. You know, and I hope that the following that follows the podcast and the Instagram has somewhat found you. And if they haven't, this is hopefully going to help. But thanks for coming on the podcast. Thanks for inviting me into the house to share, you know, the story. For everyone listening, the Instagram I'll post in the description so you can go to it. But at Oklahoma Explorer, you go to really cool places around the state and get out a lot more than I do, which, you know, is not easy. But yeah, I mean, before we dive into, I guess, the blogging side of things, how do you get to where you are now? Like, what do you do and why do you live in Tulsa?
Yeah, well, first of all, I just want to say thank you to you as well, because you mm-hmm. have, in reposting a lot of my photos, have drawn a lot of people to my page, and I owe you a debt of gratitude as well. So I'm glad that it's been mutually beneficial. But so I started, it was sort of an accident that this page even came to exist. My husband and I are avid travelers. I've always been a big traveler. We like to go everywhere and I love to take photos. I still feel weird about calling myself a photographer, because I like to take pictures, is what I say.
Right.
Because there are so many extraordinary photographers around the state who just, their skill set is way beyond what my skill set is. I know where to point and shoot, and I can manage. But I'm still very much an amateur. But so we came to a point where we weren't going to be able to travel as much as we were used to. And I have a tremendous sense of wanderlust, and I get very restless. This last year has been very difficult because I get very restless when I can't get up and go. You know, we were traveling all over. Sometimes we would be gone for weeks at a time, and that just became our routine. And so when we came to a point personally that that was going to have to cease for a while, I had to find ways to quell that restlessness. And so we started looking around at just locally places that we could visit, that we could see, that could kind of, you know, scratch that itch a little bit. And so the first place we came to, the first place we went together, and we took our dog and just took a little day trip up to Natural Falls State Park, which is still one of my favorite places to go. We just took a day trip up there. I'm a lifelong Oklahoman. I've lived all over the state, but I've been in and around Tulsa for much of my life. Mm-hmm. It's an hour and 15 minutes from here, and I had never been.
Yeah.
Which is ridiculous. When I say it out loud, I was talking to some friends earlier today who similarly are Tulsans, and they said, oh, I've never been to Natural Falls. And and so we went, and it was gorgeous. I just couldn't believe, like, this has been so close to me this whole time, and I've never been here. And it was like a light bulb just went off. And so I came home that night and I said, I think because I already had a travel Instagram page that I was posting really just for my own benefit to keep an archive of travel photos. Sure. I said, I think I'm going to start a new Instagram page. I think I'm just going to start exploring, because if this is here, this is basically an hour away.
Yeah.
Has been here the whole time and I never knew it. There's got to be just a million other places out there in this state that I've never laid eyes on. And I've been here 30 some odd years. That's ridiculous.
Right.
So I said, I think I'm going to start an Instagram page. And then if anybody else is kind of in the same boat, then maybe they'll get something out of it too, you know? And I never in my wildest dreams thought that it would go much beyond that. You know what I mean? I thought if 500 people are interested in this, if 200 people are interested in this, cool, you know, that would be great. So I posted some pictures of that trip and a couple of other things that I'd seen, and then started really just doing research is really when I dug into the Google phase, which I still rely on Google a lot to do research and find places. Yeah. And I still have a running list of places I want to see and haven't seen. So I started doing research into places sort of nearby that I hadn't seen, and came upon things like Ingalls, Oklahoma, you know, and just some various really interesting places that caught my attention. So I started a list of places that I wanted to see. And then I just started hitting the road and going various places and checking different things out and doing a little bit of research, finding out about what I was looking at. Sometimes, especially when you're in small towns in Oklahoma, people know if you're not a local, you know, you stick out like a sore thumb. And so I would sometimes attract attention from people like, oh, what are you doing here? Why are you taking pictures of that building? You know, whatever. So sometimes you just happen upon people who help you out, show you different things or explain things or show you if you're sort of not finding what you're trying to find, help you find your way to things. And so, so I just sort of came about it that way. It was very accidental.
What year was that?
That was in May of 2018.
Oh, so not too long ago.
Yeah, relatively new. I haven't been doing it very long. Had two good years, and then COVID hit this year, so I haven't been able to get out as much as I would have liked otherwise.
So you kind of, like you just mentioned, you grew up in Tulsa, but you've lived all around the state. Mm-hmm. Is that work that's taken you around the state?
It's been school.
Okay.
So I grew up in a small town just outside of Tulsa called Liberty Mounds. It's just south of Bixby. Very small. I graduated with like 36 people. Just a small rural community.
Super small, yeah.
Very small, yeah. Oklahoma has a lot of school districts, more than any other state. It's crazy. Mm-hmm. So that leads to a lot of very small schools. So I grew up there. Then I went to Miami. I did junior college in Miami, Oklahoma at NEO. Then I moved to Tahlequah and did undergrad and a master's there. Then came back to Tulsa and worked for a while. Just corporate job, just worked for a while. Kind of wasn't happy with that. Decided to get a second job as an adjunct instructor just to see if I liked that.
Sure.
And fell in love with teaching and taught at Roger State in Claremore for about 4 years. Then decided to go back to school. apparently I just can't stop going to school. So moved to Norman and did a PhD there, and then was there for about 5 years. And then after I finished up there, then came back to Tulsa.
Wow. So you have your PhD in education?
In communication.
Okay.
Is my degree.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, you, like I said, you love learning and teaching. Yeah. What kind of drew you to teaching? Like, why do I fall in love with teaching?
I don't know. My whole life has been very meandering. That's sort of just the approach I've taken to, I've just sort of happened into things. And so I knew when I was working in the corporate world, I knew that that wasn't really a good fit for me. The job was fine. I enjoyed my coworkers and things like that, but it just wasn't, It wasn't fulfilling. It didn't light me up. So I decided, because I knew with a master's I could adjunct and I could see what it felt like to be in a classroom. Yeah. I just had never done that before, and it kind of intrigued me. And so applied for an adjunct position at Roger State. Really loved it. I was just teaching basically intro to speech, communication. And so that was really fun. They were wonderful to me at RSU. They gave me a long runway to just sort of do what I wanted, which is not common as an adjunct. I was really given a lot of a lot of freedom to build the classroom the way I wanted. We were doing service learning projects. Yeah. We were doing all kinds of things that were just really, really fun. And so, but I knew if I ever wanted to take that any further and teach anything beyond really just introductory mm-hmm. classes, I needed to go back to school and yeah. finish it up. So, did that and taught the whole time I was in Norman, you know, because you get a stipend if you're able to teach, right, which is nice, with the cost of higher ed. So taught the whole time I was there, was able to teach a variety of classes, which was really fun. And then did a short stint after I finished there, a very short course in Germany, which was really, really fun.
Yeah.
I've always wanted to teach abroad. That was a lifelong sort of bucket list thing.
That must have been really cool.
It was really fun.
And being over there, I assume you probably just took full advantage of how easy it is to travel to all the other countries and when it's, you know, wherever, basically.
Absolutely.
How long were you there for?
Well, it was just a very temporary short course.
Uh-huh. Like 8 weeks?
No. It was like a 2-week course.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But I was there for about 6 weeks.
Yeah, you took full advantage of it. Yeah.
Absolutely. That's awesome. I never look a gift horse in the mouth.
Yeah, anytime
I've been really, really fortunate to just be able to travel for conferences or for, you know, for teaching opportunities and things mm-hmm. like that. And I always, you go for a conference and you're there for a month. Don't.
Right. Yeah. You're like, I have to be here for a reason. And maybe this flight is paid for from work or, I mean, it's a write off or whatever it is. And like, I'm going to take full advantage of that.
Absolutely.
Get a vacation out of it. Go see the world.
Yeah.
Which is a great lesson for everyone listening.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's so funny because I'm such a big believer in following your passion, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? And for me, I got really lucky because I didn't know that was my passion when I went into it. And I'm not teaching now. We moved back to Tulsa. There are no jobs to be found here. And that was pre-COVID. So
yeah.
It's a tough,
now it's even worse.
It's a tough world out there.
Yeah.
But I would have students come into my office hours and just talk to me about, you know, and I remember being 22 and being mm-hmm. like, what do I want to do with my life? I'm much older than that now, and I still don't know what I want to do when I grow up, you know, but they would talk to me about, you know, well, I'm an international business major. I don't know if this is really what I want to do. And I would say, what do you like? What do you enjoy? You know, and they would say, well, I'm international business because I want to travel and I think it's a good gateway. But I would sort of push and say, well, what do you like? What do you like?
What do you do when you're not having to study?
Right,
exactly.
What
do you enjoy doing?
And they, you know, one student in particular that I was having this conversation with said, well, I like art. And I was like, well, I don't know if you know this, there is art all over the world, you know?
Literally all over the world. Some of the best of it is all over the world.
And you have this tremendous gift. One of the biggest gifts I think that you have as a student, as an undergrad, is your electives. You know what I mean?
Yeah, 100%.
The free courses that you have the opportunity to take on any topic. Mm-hmm. And those are really, I think, the gate, you know, the key to finding what your passion is, because you can take anything you want. And so when you find yourself in classes and you find a class that you're not just struggling through mm-hmm. to stay awake, you're actually engaged and interested.
Yeah.
Those are really good markers for what might be a good pathway, at least to follow for a little while. So I don't know.
So while you really love traveling, while you were doing this, you had your own Instagram that you created for just travel in mm-hmm. general. And mm-hmm. obviously with your communication background, you know how to communicate through social media and all the other ones and the blog as well.
Yeah.
And then COVID happens, I guess.
Yeah.
But you already start the Oklahoma stuff before COVID happened.
Yeah. Yeah. I had been doing, you know, a full 2 years of Oklahoma Explorer before COVID happened. So, was able to get a lot under my belt, a lot of miles on the car. Fortunately before all that happened, and then COVID sets in, and I mean, I've basically been in full lockdown for the year.
Yeah.
You know, just the uncertainty of the virus and not knowing, mm-hmm. you know, it's difficult to know from one person to the next how we actually did have COVID in December, and it was scary, you know, it's not something to mess around with. So, so I have mostly this last year just been kind of pulling from the archive. Mm-hmm. I've been pulling from photos that I already had you know, re-editing or re-cropping photos that I had or just reposting, because the page has been consistently growing since mm-hmm. it started. So even if it's something or a location that I posted before or a photo that I posted before, there's a lot of new eyes on it.
100%. People need to be reminded too.
So,
That's
so,
really cool.
I'm fortunate in that respect that I could still continue to produce content,
yeah,
even though there were all of these travel limitations.
Yeah. So when you were doing the blog, would you, I mean, like you said, you had this list, right? And you still have this list, which is a lot of things you haven't crossed off yet, which is the great thing about the state is there's so many, like, you know, there is obviously little gems in every city and town and, mm-hmm. and you know, loads of little places, especially down Route 66 or, you know, but it's almost impossible to take all of them off the list, which is great because as a content like producer or someone who needs to go find new places to travel, you know, like the great thing, and people ask me all the time, like, where should I go for like ideas? And I'm like, either Instagram, you know, there's yours, there's a few other travel, okay, obviously as well, and a bunch of others. But I always tell them, like, go to the Travel Oklahoma website and download the brochures or ask for the brochures and they will send them to you, mail them to you for free.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I'll put that link in the description too, so you can go to it and they will send you, you know, and you can get them every year, a giant box full of all the brochures from every single county, every single tribal nation, like literally everything you want. And they will tell you where to go. And that list is endless.
Yes.
And that's been awesome. That for me has been great. And I haven't got out nearly as much as you have over the last couple of years, but I know that that resource is there.
Travel Okay has been a tremendous resource for me. I am constantly looking to them for inspiration, ideas, information about places that I plan to visit. They have all the information, not just about places to see, but events going on everywhere. You know, there's obviously, we have a ton of festivals around the state, and you can always find out about different festivals going on in different towns. And we have a lot of really unique ones.
It's, I didn't realize we had a balloon festival. Like in one of the tribal nations has a balloon festival.
Yeah, there's one in Tulsa too, usually a balloon festival that's really nice. I mean, we have a Bigfoot festival that I have not yet made it to that is
big news this year, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely on my list. I mean, we've got the Porter Peach Festival's great. Oktoberfest here is always huge and really, really fun. The Renaissance Fair is really fun. Great people watching. There's a ton, just so many different, the Prague Kalachi Festival is really fun. So many different
things.
It's endless. And my list of places to visit is longer now than I was when I started. I mean, I'm constantly adding to it.
That's awesome.
The great thing about Instagram too is you can not only follow pages, but you can follow hashtags. So you can find so much. I mean, you can just spend your life on there and get inspired. So.
Yeah. I always tell people when people ask me, you know, like how much time do you spend on your phone on Instagram? And I'm like, it's more than I like would I'm comfortable telling you because it is literally endless. But then, you know, at the same time when they ask you, hey, could you like run, you know, well, how can we pay you to do our social media? I'm like, no. Because the amount of money that you'd want to pay me or have to pay me for it to be justified like on an hourly basis, it's not worth it. I was like, please find someone in your, you know, in your company that'll do it for you for a little bit of a raise rather than an actual, like, you know, thousands of dollars a month.
Well, and it's ever changing, right? It's ever evolving. So like, I'm not on TikTok. I haven't moved into the new spaces yet at Clubhouse or any of those. I feel a little bit like a dinosaur sometimes because I'm still sort of, I'm not quite up like some of these influencers are, but
I mean, there's it is a full-time, it can be a career, right? It's a full-time job. And there's some very, 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 very good people out there that do it and take it seriously and take it as a business and run it as a business. And I'm slowly figuring that out. So when you find a place, do you, you know, you jump in the car, you go, or your husband, you both go with the dogs or with the family, the cats or whatever, and just go and just enjoy it for the day?
Yeah, most of the time it's just me. Not always. There have been times that my husband's come along with me or a friend and I have gone off, and it kind of depends on a lot of different things, where I'm going, how long I plan to be there, what everyone's schedule is like. So most of the time I'm just doing day trips. So I'm setting out in the morning, I'm heading out somewhere and coming back, you know, however long after, you know, depending on how long I'm going to be there, how far away it is. So there have been, you know, if I go up to the Panhandle, you know, I've done a couple of trips up there. Yeah. That's a weekend trip because it's really far away. You know, if you get as far as Kenton from here, that's 8 hours from here. I mean, this is a big state.
It's a long way.
So, some of the, you know, it kind of varies depending on how far away I'm planning to go. Even places like Koger, which is a place I've gone back and back to because I love it.
Is that the place that has the famous gas station in it from Rain Man?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. I mean, that's on the other side of Oklahoma City. That's 3 hours from here. That's a pretty good little haul. But yeah, so usually I'll just take off and leave in the morning, plan to be gone however long, you know, and keep provisions in the car, you know, always water, food, just depending, because I don't know, sometimes
extra gas can
just in case you've got to be prepared,
right?
Because I've had mishaps with the car, I've had flat tires, I've had, you know, keep my AAA card handy, but yeah, so I set out, and then I usually have a pretty clear picture at least of the main thing I want to see, and then everything else sometimes is spur of the moment. Sometimes it's very specifically laid out. It just kind of depends on what I'm seeing and, you know, what the circumstances are. It can kind of vary. But one of the trips I took out to the Panhandle was with a good friend of mine, and we had so much fun. It was just a little girl's weekend, and we just had a blast.
It's Black Mesa, and see the stars and just be up there and... Yeah, you're right. I mean, it's a long way. It's what, four and a bit, there and back, and then four back?
Oh, more than,
longer? Is it really?
Yeah, I mean, it's depending on, if you get all the way out to the Black Mesa, I mean, I think it's like 7 hours from here.
Wow, that's, so you're right. You have to do it over a weekend to make it justified than driving out there for 7 hours and spending an hour and coming home.
Yeah, it doesn't make sense.
It doesn't make sense at all, does it?
And there's so much to see. That's one of my favorite parts of the state, because there's almost an eeriness to it, because... You know, there's this tragic history in that part of the state with the Dust Bowl and the Dust Bowl houses. There's still echoes of the past that you can see really vividly. And there's just something about, and my dad was from that part of the state too. He's from Gage. And so there's a personal, you know, history there with me that's special, because he passed away when I was little. So there's a really special connection, but also there's just something really fascinating about that area that is really appealing to me. I really enjoy being there.
That's really cool. I mean, it's awesome, right, to see, and I'm sure people, like, we probably get messages that people like get inspired and they see things that you post and like, oh, I went to, or I'm going there next week, and, or, you know, you just inspired me to know that this is possible. Or for people who work, you know, 60 hours a week, they live vicariously through your Instagram. But it's nice to have that impact, and I'm sure it feels great when you get a message from someone that says, you know, they ask for a recommendation, where should I go, and they're like, wow, that was awesome, like, where should I go next weekend?
It's really wonderful. That's been one of the most rewarding parts of the whole experience, is getting those kind of messages. Or even if I post a picture and I see people tagging their friends, like, hey, let's go here. You know, that's really fun, because that's not just, oh, they're going to go explore this place, but they're going to make a memory with their friend. And that's really cool. Enjoy that.
So, I mean, the day trip thing is so good, isn't it? Because like you said, you can be there and back in a day. You don't have to really worry if you have pets. You don't have to worry about, like, people looking after the pets for too long. And or if you have kids, grandma can take the kids, or you can at least palm them off for 8 hours and it's okay. What has been, I guess, some of the places that really stand out that were kind of that you, I guess, weren't sure about going to, but there was enough to intrigue you to get you out there, and then when you got there, you're like, well, this place is amazing. How have I not been yet? Other than Natural Falls, obviously, which you've been to.
Natural Falls is a big one. There have been a lot of places that have taken me by surprise. You know, I grew up not far from Okmulgee, Oklahoma.
Okay.
And despite the fact that I grew up not far from there, I hadn't spent much time there. And a couple of times, especially the first time I went out to just shoot around the historic downtown, I was blown away with how charming it was. I couldn't believe it. And I just was kicking myself again. It's one of those things where... I had been in this mode of, oh, if I have vacation time, I want to get out of Oklahoma. I want to go somewhere else. And now that I was exploring locally, I was just constantly surprised and pleasantly surprised by what I was finding. But that particular downtown is so much fun. They have taken so much care. They even have a hashtag called Okmulgee Rising. They've put a lot of time and energy into revitalizing their downtown. There's these incredible vintage murals that you can see all over downtown. There's the Orpheum Theater, which is celebrating 100 years this year. I mean, it's really historic, Native history there as well. And there's just so much, even, you know, things as simple as putting a piano out on the sidewalk and with a sign that says play me, you know, it invites engagement and it invites tactile experience. It's not just things to look at, but it's, you know, it's, that was a downtown that really, really shocked me.
Yeah.
Especially because I had grown up so close to it, but not spending much time there.
It's a real surprise.
So that was really fun. There have been a couple of places. My mind is blanking and I'm trying to think. The town where the Toy and Action Figure Museum, my mind is completely blanking as to what town that is. I will look it up. But
you'll remember it within like three.
As soon as I leave or whatever, it stops rolling.
Yeah, you remember.
Remember, but yeah, that's another wonderful little spot. The Toy and Action Figure Museum is very cheeky and fun.
So just a museum of literally toys and action figures.
It's like reliving, especially if you're a child of the 80s or 90s.
Yeah,
it is reliving your childhood. It is every imaginable action figure, toy. Everything from superheroes to Alf to oh my god, everything.
I didn't know about that. That's so cool.
It's crazy.
Yeah. How big is it?
It's, I mean, bigger than you would think.
I guess how long would it take you to go through it?
I mean, you could probably go through it if you're giving it a fair amount of time, you could spend an hour there. You could probably go faster if you were in a hurry, but it's a really fun little spot.
Yeah.
And you can take the train. And this is another thing that I really love is the Heartland Flyer that you can pick up in Norman or OKC. I usually will drive to Norman and pick it up. You can go all the way to Fort Worth or you can stop. You can stop in Ardmore. You can stop at various spots along the way. But it's really fun to just take the train and you stop off and it'll drop you off in some of these downtowns too.
That's so cool.
It's really fun. There's a lot of quirkiness too.
There's a lot of museums in this state. I didn't realize how many there were. There's so many.
There are, and there's even a lot. I mean, it's been so long since I've even been to like Gilcrease, which is one of the best museums in Tulsa. Yeah. I'm so embarrassed to say that I haven't been there in much longer than I should have been there long before I have. But you know, there's so many great museums here, and you know, now we're going to be getting the Bob Dylan Center, which is going to be amazing. The Woody Guthrie Center, that's relatively new, is wonderful. It's really been exciting to see Tulsa become kind of this mecca for music museums, which is really, really cool to see.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome, isn't it? And to know that, like I said, these places are, they're either already here or they're coming, or even if they're here, they're getting a lot of volunteer or money funding. Mm-hmm. So it shows that the state values it and they want to get people in. And that's really cool. It's, you know, it's great to have the state so invested in keeping people here, right?
Yes.
And they know, I'm sure they know, and everyone else knows. They're like, there's so many other places to go to, right? People, the spring break while recording this, and people are in Colorado skiing, or they're going to the beach, or they're in Destin, like every other Oklahoman goes on spring break or whatever.
Yeah.
But I'm sure it's nice to know that, hey, you have a giant list of places you can go in Oklahoma and spend the weekend. You can go to, I mean, Broken Bow obviously is the new craze now, and everyone's kind of down there, and so is every influencer taking photos and all the rest of it, however. But the good thing is it's there, it's bringing money in. I had a few comments when I post some stuff about cabins down there, and there's a guy, Cameron, I think, photography or something like that. I post his photos all the time, and he takes, I guess he's in the real estate world down there, so he's taking a lot of the photos of all the really cool cabins. And I think someone commented on it about, like, they were a local. Mm-hmm. And you could see that they were a little bit pissed off that all these people were coming in because they're like, it's not what it used to be and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, yeah, but it's a lot of money that's bringing in. Like, it's probably paying a lot of the taxes, making better roads and making the place better and bringing money in. And there's businesses that have started up down there that, you know, okay, you might have real estate developers coming in from out of state. But you get that everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
But it's bringing you know, dollars to the state, to the city, which is, we need more of that, don't
we? It's been the same in Pawhuska. You know, Pawhuska has seen such a huge uptick in visitors because of the Pioneer Woman, and that's been tremendous. I mean, it's really done a lot to help shape their local economy. And I can say the same really for the revitalization of Route 66. You know, Oklahoma has more miles of Route 66 than any other state. Damn. And there's been a lot of effort put in and continuing effort put into make that a genuine tourist destination that people right. want to come to. And there have been so many people who've been instrumental in that, Mary Beth Babcock and mm-hmm. Lieutenant Governor Pinnell and Reese Martin. You know, I mean, there have been so many people who are working really hard, even with, you know, getting things like Buck Adams open, getting the Motherwood mm-hmm. Market open. And now the signs that they're putting up, they're trying to improve sure. the sign infrastructure, because Route 66 has gotten so broken up that it's a little bit hard to follow.
It's tricky.
So now that they're trying to improve the sign infrastructure, that's going to help a lot too.
Yeah.
So
what are the places, I guess, that you haven't crossed off yet that's like, hey, I can't wait to go to this place?
So I haven't been to Broken Bow yet.
Yeah.
I'm like the only person
Same.
In Oklahoma.
You're good. I am not.
Apparently. I need to start saving my pennies so I can afford a cabin.
Yeah.
But no, I haven't been out to Broken Bow yet. There's still a lot of southern Oklahoma that I haven't mm-hmm. hit that I really want
that's
to.
That's a weekend trip, isn't it?
That's
it's
a weekend
really
trip.
A day
yeah, that's going to be a time yeah. investment. I still, you know, there's like I mentioned earlier, there's a lot of quirky things that I have a real love for, mm-hmm. Whether that's just silly little roadside attractions.
But it has so much like character in it.
Yeah.
And that's what brings out, I think I reshared one of your photos of the of Harley's place up in,
oh yeah.
you know, I'm just like, which yeah. I have to go see him.
Make it a point to do that.
It's just it just looks awesome. I'm like, I don't care if I have to drive 4 hours to get there.
It's
I just
want
to be there. Right. And like, there's mm-hmm. so many places like that.
Yeah. There's the Will Hay Nelson is the one that I was thinking of that I haven't seen yet. I think that's in Chandler. It's on Route 66.
Okay.
And it's literally just a haystack that someone has drawn up to look like Willie Nelson. It's fantastic. So that is, that's a big to-do that's on my bucket
What is
list.
The kind of like the cement mixer that's fallen off that someone has painted? That's,
the Wingenon space capsule.
That too.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
I love the ingenuity of Oklahomans, and I love their quirkiness, and I love their, it takes commitment, right? To say, okay, well, there's this cement mixer that was in an accident. Now there's this giant, you know, cement mixer on the side of the road. Let's paint it up to look like a space capsule.
Yeah.
And there's something about that commitment to something so silly and quirky that I just love.
Yeah.
I was sad to hear that, you know, Chris Barbie's bowling ball art yard is no longer there. That was one of my favorite places to go. And that's been kind of a interesting part of kind of being sidelined for the last year, because I'm learning things too, and I love that communal aspect of being on Instagram and having people even correct me, which is great, because not having been out there and pulling from the archive, I posted a picture of his art yard and someone said, that's not there anymore. And I was just like,
no,
what?
Crushed.
I had no idea. I was devastated.
Yeah.
But, you know, learning those things too, I appreciate that feedback. But yeah, so there's been an interesting archival aspect to the project as well, because I've taken pictures of things that don't exist anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, the leaning tower that's in my logo,
right,
you know, the Adams Green elevator, that doesn't exist anymore. And I was there. I mean, we specifically made a trip out there because I knew that was coming down and I knew I wanted to see it, and I didn't know exactly when it was coming down, and I wanted to get there before they tore it down, and fortunately got there just a few days. I was one of the last people to shoot it before it got destroyed. But
So. I mean, with travel, obviously, kind of travel goes, food goes hand in hand with traveling. And the great thing about these small towns is they have some of the best burger joints, bakeries, like just greasy places that you're like, my stomach is going to hate me for the next week, but this is so good. Cookies or whatever it is.
Yes.
Anything that really stands out that you have been to that was like a total surprise, and then places that you on the list that you want to try?
Yeah, Shoto is, you know, being a large Amish community, they have some unbelievable food.
Okay.
In Shoto, there's a couple of, there's a restaurant there that I ate at, and I'm struggling to remember the name, but it's very easy to find. It's right there right in the heart of town. And that was really, really wonderful. And then they have a place that sells cheese and baked goods and wonderful, just definitely a foodie destination that you wouldn't expect, but very, very worth it. Places that I haven't tried yet. I mean, it's been so long since I've even been in a restaurant that now I'm just like, what's that like?
Overwhelming
to think about. Yeah.
Yeah.
I, I'm trying to think of a food experience. You know, there are so many great places popping up all the time, even here in Tulsa and in Oklahoma City. Really great farm to table kind of experiences. I'm a big fan of that. There's a new place really just down the road here that opened within the last year. That's a Detroit pizza place called Pizza 313. And it's very good. We do take away from there sometimes, and it's really, really good pizza. But yeah, lots of good food.
So much. That's the hard thing when I ask you a question like that, but it's a good thing when you're like hungry and you're like, and you go open up Google or whatever and like, this place is awesome. This place is awesome. Now I have to choose. It's like opening Netflix and picking a movie, which is never easy to do.
Exactly.
So obviously this year now, thankfully everybody's slowly getting the vaccine. We're in the third wave or phase, however they say it. Plan is once you can get out, like, where do you want to go next? And then I guess now with the blog, right, it's and the Instagram page, you probably didn't think that it was going to become what it has, but you know, what I guess would be your, where are you going, and then I guess what would be your plans with the blog going forward?
I mean, I never in my wildest dreams would have imagined that it would grow to be what it is. I do hope at some point, and I've said this kind of since, it's been in the back of my mind, I guess, since the beginning. I've probably said it out loud after maybe the first year, that I would like to create. I have two specific ideas for books that I would like to do, two very different sort of concepts or visual representations. But I have some ideas I would like to at least turn these into books. In terms of the next place, I keep coming back to getting back to Eureka Springs, and I know that's not in Oklahoma, but I do sometimes.
On the way.
I do sometimes post from just very
tiny bit across the border.
The border, easy little weekend trips. Periodically, I have been known to post from neighboring states, and before I ever did that, I did. You know, I asked the followers, I said, will you hate me if I post from Eureka Springs or if I go to Texas or something, would you be interested in seeing this? And most of them, some of them were like, no.
If they live on the border or within an hour of it, it's like fine, right?
Yeah. But I've been really missing Eureka Springs lately. I definitely want to get down to Broken Bow. There's a lot of state parks that I still haven't been to. I haven't been to Roman Nose. I haven't been to Red Rock Canyon. I haven't been to Little Sahara. There's still places like that are definitely on my list of places I want to see. And places that I feel like if I am going to do a book eventually, places that
they
I feel like
to be in there.
Need to be in there, or it would be a huge oversight. So, definitely. I mean, again, I have this massive list. I could, if I had it in front of me, I'd be like, oh, well, I want to go here. But those are the ones that come to mind that I haven't been to. A lot of state parks, for sure.
Yeah.
We have so many great state parks here. It's just
and
incredible.
Apparently, I haven't been either, but apparently the food is now much better at state parks, thanks to the new investment from the state in upping the quality of food in the restaurants at state parks. So I've been told. I haven't been, but I've heard that now much better.
Good to know.
That's a good thing, right? Because the last thing you want to do is go to a state park and the food just be trash.
Right.
Which is great. Thank you so much for coming on the podcast. Thank you for sharing your story. I'm excited at the future ideas because I love the coffee table book idea or just a visual representation of, hey, this is the Oklahoma Explorer. This is where you should go and open up your own guide. And that's a big project. And the good thing is you have plenty of photos in the archive and you get to write and communicate and use your degree and, you know, your doctorate and stuff to do that, which is not many people say that they can do. They use their actual education to do what they do now at work. But thanks for coming on the podcast. For everyone listening, I'll post the links down in the description so you can go and see those lists and follow Instagram, all the rest of it. We'll catch you next episode. Cheers.
Thank you for having me.
This podcast is presented by the Oklahoma Hall of Fame, telling Oklahoma's story through its people since 1927. For more information on the Hall of Fame, go to www.oklahomahof.com and follow them on Instagram for daily updates at @OklahomaHOF. Also, huge shout out to RCB Bank for jumping on board to be a sponsor. RCB Bank's loan promotion is here for a limited time. Head into any of their 40 Oklahoma locations to get as low as 1.79 APR on your next car, boat, camper, or ATV. Apply online at rcbbank.com. RCB Bank, that's my bank. Rate and finance with approved credit. Restrictions apply. Member FDIC. Huge shout out to my sponsors. Thank you for listening. We'll catch you next episode. Cheers.
Thank you for listening. We are inspired by those around us and hope that you are too. Make sure you subscribe to this podcast on your favorite podcast platform and leave us a review so we can keep telling your stories. For more great Oklahoma content, follow This Is Oklahoma on Facebook and Instagram.